right, fellas, this next chopping block, I have, obviously we all tweeted, we all updated our statuses and asked for a recommendation. These come from, I just to name a couple of people, Jermaine Studwell, Alex Bach, both had this question among many others regarding—
Shout out to y'all for giving us a dope chopping block.
Definitely, and thanks for the love and support as well. But this is a topic that's kind of hot right now, and I suspect that it will remain hot for a while, and it's been debated amongst believers, I think, probably since the disciples left, you know, went to be in glory. And that is cessationism, whether the spirits, the spiritual gifts are relevant for today, particularly related to this recent Strange Fire conference held by John MacArthur and his church. A lot of people are upset about it. Some people think it was great. What do you feel about the conference, if you know anything about it at all? And beyond that, that's more specifically, not even the conference, because I would say more specifically, what are your views on the gifts of the Spirit? And are there abuses that need to be dealt with in the body?
Well, I haven't even watched it. Have any of y'all even watched any of the Strange Fire stuff? I haven't watched nothing.
I've listened to some.
Just a little
bit. Yeah, so I won't comment on that much. But just to make sure I'm clear, are we saying that, do we agree that the gifts, like healing, tongues, stuff like that,
prophecy,
still exist?
Yeah. Prophecy. Are they relevant
today? Are they still existing, relevant, and being used today? Or have they ceased and they're not being used
yes.
today? Okay, I just want to be clear.
And furthermore, some of the abuses, the alleged abuses, if you want to put it that way, that were being addressed at the conference, do they need to be addressed? And is that, you know, how do we approach that as believers? If this is an in-family debate, what should there be a degree of grace and understanding that these are secondary issues? And at what point is it a heresy, and does it become another gospel when it's abused?
Let's start with where we stand.
Okay.
Go ahead. Charlene.
Where do you think I stand?
Where do I think you stand, yeah, personally? I think you still believe the gifts exist, but that's because I know you.
Right. Yeah, so I think one of the difficult things with this whole topic has been the lack of clarity in terms of definitions and yeah. what's meant. So what's meant by charismatic,
yeah.
right? What's meant by the gifts?
Yeah.
Cessationism, continuationism.
Yeah.
So what I've seen is that you have terms that are being thrown out,
yeah.
like the charismatic movement,
yeah.
That kind of lumps a whole bunch of people in together. And so I think that that's problematic if it's not properly defined. So if the debate is, in terms of what I understand the debate, it's are the gifts of the Spirit still relevant for today? I think any person who is a cessationist would say yes, absolutely, gifts of the Spirit.
Yeah.
But the question is, in particular, the what would be called the miraculous gifts or the sign, so-called sign gifts, as was just mentioned,
yeah.
prophecy, tongues, healing. Do people have the gift of prophecy today? Do people have the gift of healing today? I think that's the question. So I just want to make that.
Where do you stand on those miraculous gifts?
Yeah. So I don't see. Okay. All right,
Shred.
Right, come on, Jack. Yeah.
So I need to.
Have a song for this one, dude.
So I need to put a qualifier in place first, and that qualifier is that I do not believe that there's a such thing as new revelation. That is, I believe that this is it. This the Bible is sufficient. The canon is closed.
Yeah.
I don't believe that anyone is saying something today that should be added on to
yeah,
the canon, based off of Hebrews 1 primarily. But with that said, I also don't believe that there's any scriptural warrant to believe that there's no longer the gift of prophecy.
I concur.
Or the gift of healing. or even the gift of speaking in tongues. Yeah. As far as speaking in tongues is concerned, there are clear biblical guidelines that must be abided by.
Yeah.
No more than two or three, there must be interpretation, and I believe that they're actual languages.
Yeah.
I believe that what we see and hear as so-called tongues, I don't think is actually biblical tongues. Mm-hmm. So that's my long way of saying that I'm not a cessationist.
I would concur with you, just real quick on my perspective. I would also say that I've heard, I think there's maybe some scriptural support, obviously, for languages in certain contexts, and also perhaps in the prayer closet, groanings from with, you know, spiritual groanings that aren't necessarily articulated languages or anything like that, that I think scripture speaks about. And in all honesty, man, some of this, I will say that I don't find any biblical support for the idea that those miraculous gifts have ceased, or that they would in this epoch or this era. So I don't see any support for that. But I would just tack on there, I don't think that necessarily if you're not speaking a language that it can't be tongues, if you're praying to the Lord and your spirit is crying out to God with some sort of auditory sound or what have you. But I don't know if I'd call that tongues. See, I don't know.
An utterance that couldn't be understood.
Yeah, an utterance, yeah, or something like that.
And people refer to as angelic tongues.
Yeah.
No, I'm not serious. That's what they're
Go ahead, bro.
And you would.
Yeah, well, my pushback on that, on the idea of a private prayer language, I think is what it's called.
But that's not what I'm saying.
Oh, that's not what you're talking
about.
Well,
no, but I would love to hear that.
Okay. Yeah, so the challenge that I would have with that idea is that it would go against what the purpose of gifts are.
Edification.
Right. So gifts are given by the Spirit for the body. It's for others, not for personal use it's not for me. It's for the body. And so I would have a question about how that is for the body in any kind of way. And if it's not for the body,
I think in the context of the passage, though, it's not in relation to. It says sometimes the Spirit groans. And to what degree is that literal or figurative?
Yes, I think we would have to look at that passage.
Yeah, look at that in context.
We talk about more than we say is when speaks in tongues builds up himself.
Right.
Yeah.
Brian, what's your view?
Brian, this is where it gets fun.
What do you mean it's where it gets fun? I am not a cessationist.
What does that mean?
In that, everybody calm down. Everybody calm down. In that, I agree in terms of you cannot support the Bible. You cannot support with the Bible. I don't believe that they have stopped, which is the biggest reason I am not. And there's too much going against it. With that being said, though, I think I'm just unclear. I'm unclear on. And I think I also want to acknowledge on the flip side, I'm just very confident in God doing what he wants, when he wants. And so I don't think the Lord is boxed into what I would understand him to do at all. He will do what he's going to do. And so with that being said, I do think I've seen an inconsistency with how people do talk about the more miraculous gifts. I think I'm more comfortable, even though I even feel like it's kind of a cop out a little bit in terms of the gifts being used in the confirmation of the gospel and unreached people group or what have you, places where the gospel is being confirmed, because that's even harder to you can't really support that. So even if we're going to use that, you almost cut your legs out from underneath because you can't really support that. I don't think with the Bible either, and so. I don't know. I know I've seen abuses. What is modernly communicated as prophecy, I think, is sometimes confusing in terms of what it actually is. It's not very helpful for me in terms of understanding what, I guess kind of the more conservative modern understanding what prophecy is in the life of a local church, I don't think is very clarifying. Although I'm open to that being a definition too, it just isn't very helpful to, I think giving definition to what we're seeing in 1 Corinthians 14. And tongues, I'm actually open to there being, it's clear that there's actual language is being considered in the Bible. I'm open to it not being as well. Just some of the statements Paul said of himself speaking in tongues. Although we would clearly say it's more, he would say it's more edifying not to in his prophesy. So I say that, but I haven't seen, I also don't know, and I know this is a poor argument from experience, but it's still an argument nonetheless. I haven't ever seen anybody support, although, and you might can give some pushback on this, the gifts of healing and the gifts of miracles. I haven't really heard anybody defend that, but unless it's the unreached or, kind of areas where the gospel isn't really known, dark areas where it's being confirmed. I know people are comfortable talking about the gifts of miracles, gifts of healing over in those types of settings, but not here in the States at all, unless usually it's in a context where I'm usually in disagreement with how they just understand the work of the Spirit in Scripture at large. And so I've seen that as an inconsistency of some continuationists in terms of, because usually I think they kind of lean more heavily just on prophecy and tongues in terms of what I've understood. And I'm not saying all of them think that way at all, just it's just been my interaction with the concept. So I wouldn't consider myself either one, just because I think both categories are not really helpful, usually.
Okay. I mean, flat out, I think the gifts are still at work. I have no scriptural support to say that they're not. I think the only way to say that they're not is to say I've never seen them, I don't see them, or I haven't seen them be used correctly. And so I think the Bible just lets us know clearly about healings, about tongues. And I agree that in a lot of cases we've seen it be abused. And I've been even guilty of, after seeing it abused so much, me completely shunning the idea because I've seen it abused so much. I just think that's really dangerous, y'all. Like you say, and just to even for clarity for people watching, even with Brian saying like I'm unclear, none of us are saying that God does not heal today. So none of us are saying that. Just to be clear, in support of you.
Oh yeah,
I know you're not.
He heals. He does. Amen. And he does miracles.
Absolutely. Yeah. So
well, that maybe that'd be helpful. When we say gifts, are we?
Because cessationists wouldn't deny that.
Right. And I think that's sometimes unfair in terms of how people are conflicting with their perspective, because they're saying, "Oh, they don't believe that the Spirit. He's not the third person of the Trinity." By the time he gets that, well, that's not fair either.
But people just thinking of a person who might be a Calvinist or a Reformer, and people like they don't believe in any
evangelism
gifts,
like, or something. Right. It's like, so let's just assume that both parties affirm that the Spirit of God does miraculous things. He heals, and he does what he wants, when he wants, where he wants.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And we actually, I pray for people to be healed.
Right.
I pray for miracles to be done. Right. And I'm completely comfortable in doing so because I serve a God that does those things and has done those things. So.
Now, with that being said, because I think most cessationists I've spoken to and continuationists I've spoken to, they would affirm both of those as heartily. So if somebody's sick, they will pray, and they will pray fervently, and they'll believe God. Now, the question is, what's the gift part, though?
Do people have the gift of healing?
Is that a gift, even? Like, or are we just saying, so for instance, if Brother Tony's arm got broke, right, and we're like, I'm like, all right, let's pray for him. I pray for Tony. He's healed. Does that now mean I have a gift of healing? Or does that mean God has just answered my prayer for healing? Or both? How do y'all understand somebody having a gift? Like, do y'all think it's a gift? Or do you think it's just somebody expressing that type of activity by the Spirit of God?
So I would say that I think it can be either or, and I think it can be, or it could be, and I don't think it has to be something that's always happening with that person for it to make it a gift.
Like an abiding gift, for instance.
Yeah, an abiding gift. So, for example, if Tony breaks his arm and it's just me and I pray for him and I'm like, Lord, I just pray, boom, he's healed, right? I think it would be safe to say Jason has the gift of healing, right? Even though it may not be an abiding gift. So I may not pray for every person, and every person I pray for be specifically healed. I don't know how y'all feel about that.
I wouldn't agree with that.
Okay.
So I would just say you pray for somebody and God healed them. But I wouldn't say Jason has the gift of healing. So that's what I'm saying. That's the language where I'm thinking, I've prayed for people when they've been healed. I've been prayed for before I've been healed. But there's not something in my mind that would has associated to any degree of commonality.
You've prayed for people and they've been healed. And you've been prayed for, and you've been
healed. And I've been healed, right. I was going to say, this isn't, it doesn't happen all the time.
Because this is where the muddiness for, I think, even dealing with scripture comes in for me. So, like, when I read scripture and I see people that have healed others, we don't get the full scope of what that looked like walking with that gift.
Right.
You know what I mean? So
miracles, though. So I guess, so you say gifts of miracles, I'm thinking something I'm not seeing regularly that I'm supposed to be confused is happening as a gift.
Right.
And so.
But even with that definition.
Yeah.
I'm saying even with that definition, like, healing is a freaking miracle.
Right.
Right? So, I mean.
But the Bible does, it does provide.
Right, but I'm just saying. That's something you ain't normally seeing. You ain't just walking down a block and going somebody. So even that in and of itself is like, wow, like this is a... So when I look at scripture and I see times where... So I know that several of the apostles, all of them. So when I think of one of them in particular, when he was sick, I'm speaking of Peter, who was sick.
Which situation?
Peter was sick, and instead of healing him, they told him to drink some wine.
Timothy.
Mm-hmm. So I think about that instance, like, what does that look like? You know what I'm saying? Like, because obviously the dudes that were around him, we've seen other times in scripture where they've actually healed dudes.
Paul brought somebody back to life.
Absolutely.
By the Spirit of God. And he couldn't fix his eye.
Right.
What we would believe, historically, is that something wrong with that. He had a thorn in the flesh. Right. God, please take it from me. God doesn't take it from him.
Exactly.
Right. Whatever that was, he couldn't fix it.
Right. Or even with this Timothy situation, like, I mean, if you have the gift of healing, it's like, in terms of I heal when I pray or whatever that looks like, because I don't even know exactly what it looks like other than me praying for this person and boom, now Timothy is healed. You know, he's no longer sick. So would I then have to come to the conclusion that they didn't have the gift of healing?
That it was just a sovereign act of God,
exactly.
Not a gift of healing.
Exactly.
And in that case, what is the gift of healing?
Well, let me ask this, and I just want to hear how y'all interact with this text, 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Mm-hmm. Starting at verse 4, it says, "Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who empowers them all and everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. For to one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, and to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit. To another faith by the same Spirit. To another gifts of healing by the one Spirit. To another the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, the ability to distinguish between spirits. To another, various kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. All these are empowered by one and the same Spirit, who apportions to each one individually as he wills."
Mm-hmm.
So,
I think that supports what I said.
Right. So then the question I would have, though, is, so by a plain reading of this text, would it be fair to say that the Spirit gives people gifts of healing or miracles or prophecy
as he sees fit?
Well, yeah, I think so.
Okay, so you think a person can have the gift?
Right. I guess I'm saying I'm rejecting the idea that just because, so I think it's different between having a gift and just doing something that is consistent with what a gift would be for. So for instance, someone has a gift of helps or leadership, but somebody leads something once. I'm not, in my mind, he's making gift not mean an abiding, or that you're, for instance, you would be gifted with. To me, when I read this in a plain sense, and it could just be culturally how I'm understanding the passage. Mm-hmm. So another, the gift of working miracles. So uh-huh. Not working a miracle, it's working miracles. Uh-huh. So you're the miracles worker.
But I don't know.
You have the ability to work miracles.
But.
No, wait, continue.
So to me, that has a more abiding sense to me in terms of somebody's contribution to the body. So it's
Do you think that's what this is teaching?
I think so.
See, I don't. And I think the using the S, like, so you're taking the word miracles with the S, and thinking that he's actually implying a person doing multiple miracles.
That's what they do, yeah.
And so what I get when I read that text is when he's using the word miracles, he's not necessarily just trying, because he says as he sees fit.
Yeah.
So we know that there's a clause on miracles. So if the Spirit does it as he sees fit, and the Spirit sees fit to do it now, once, another time later, or once, then never later, that's still as he sees fit.
So do you treat the other gifts in the same way? So let's say the gift of teaching.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say. Do you see the gift of teaching as, like, would you not say, man, that pastor clearly has the gift of teaching?
Mm-hmm.
In an abiding sense, not just a one-time.
But I think it can be abiding.
All pastors should have the gift of teaching.
But I think it can. I think it. I would say it can be abiding. I'm not saying it can't be abiding.
So you're not saying that healing or miracles can't be abiding?
No.
He's just saying they also don't have to be.
Yes.
So he's saying you can have the gift and it not be an abiding gift.
Because as the Spirit sees fit.
Okay. So it can be abiding.
It can be abiding as well.
Do you agree with that, bro? God's servant.
So I guess what I'm saying, this, how I understand these passages, I'm more so speaking of in terms of abiding. So I would reject that they're speaking in terms of abiding or not abiding, because at that point, it almost, in my understanding, what Paul's trying to get at in terms of how the Spirit has distributed, he says to one he's given, to the other he's given, it almost seems like he has, and based on what I'm understanding, he has given gifts to one, not this random, you never know who has what. You can do anything to
them. Okay, so then you believe that this is talking about abiding gifts and that people today have these abiding gifts.
Right, and we wouldn't say just because it's abiding, that means you're going to be able to do it until you die or what have you, but there's an abiding sense of, a staying sense of giftedness.
Of miracles.
Right. As I would understand the plain reading of that.
Yeah.
But when I see this, when I see the Spirit saying,
"Wait, would you disagree?"
I don't think the deaf.
You disagree?
But
I don't.
Don't let him squiggle out.
We'll
come back.
Okay.
But I don't think the qualification is on the miracles with the S.
But you're getting caught up on that. Take away the miracles part. To me, I think it just fits with either each gift. So it's not miracle specific.
Well, what I'm saying is I think the qualifier is as he sees fit, as the Spirit sees fit.
Well, I would understand that to be more towards his distribution, not in terms of the nature of the gift. Right?
Got you.
And, but you would say in terms of that.
Mike, what's your view?
Mike has been safe. Stay safe, brother.
Shaq. Can we have some congregational? Can we exercise some congregational?
Give us some, Shaq.
Are we wrapping up?
I want to know what you just. I would say, are you saying that these are not in a? These aren't staying gifts. These are just. What are you?
And saying? I'm saying they are abiding gifts. I just want to be clear on that.
We heard you, Jay.
No. I'm just making sure.
Yeah, right. So from my reading of the text, it seems that they're. The gifts that the Spirit gives, abiding gifts, right? The challenge I have and the reason why I hesitate is because I start to think, and now I'm going straight from experience.
Right.
Like, man, does anybody have that, the gift of miracles?
That's my.
And if they do, like, why don't we see them?
Even in Scripture, we don't see that like, pattern that way.
Right, right. That's my only question about that. Mm-hmm. Like, okay, like,
in other countries.
Like, where's the dude? Because you always hear from somebody else. Like, it's always a couple persons removed. Like, the 6 degrees of separation. Like, I know somebody that knew somebody that had to.
That's exactly what I'm saying in terms of it's an argument from experience. Right. Which we say is not.
Throw it's a big mud ball in the center of this thing.
You perform miracles.
I know we gotta wrap up.
You have the gift of miracles.
But I have to throw a mud ball.
You have the gift of miracles.
Because we need to mention this. Do you think in any way faith plays a role in it?
Of course. We read that Jesus went into towns and people weren't healed because of their faith.
So
he was the divine word,
and there's a gift of faith too. Like, so I think
it's the spirit as it works.
That's why I'm bringing it up. Because
and I'm going to be careful with how I say this, but I think believers are given the certain gifts that they're given with belief in Christ as part of their union with him and his distribution of the inheritance guarantee now, such as we get God dwelling in us, right? So this, we get the spirit when we believe. So it's not like you believe and then you're kind of saved and then you need another baptism and get the real, you get the spirit, like for real. It's like, no, we believe when you're saved, when you confess and you believe, when you're regenerated, you get the spirit of God, right? Everybody here?
Absolutely.
I believe, this is like when Paul was like, I say, not the Lord, but I. I think this goes back to almost what you were talking about in terms of whose prerogative it is in distributing gifts to how he distributes them. Because in the context here, faith is not the factor in terms of receiving gifts. It's the Spirit distributes for the good of the body as he sees fit. I think he gives us what he gives us by grace. And now I think the exercise of them does have much to do with faith. I think it has much to do with faith. I don't think the reception of them have to do with faith, though.
But yeah, and can I just add this? I just want to throw this last little piece in, because I know we got to wrap it up. But one of the challenging parts about this conversation is that, and I think this is one of the things that the evil one uses, which is that it takes the focus off of Jesus oftentimes when this subject comes up. And at the end of the day, the role of the Holy Spirit is to testify about the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus said that when the Spirit comes, when the Spirit of truth comes, he will testify about me.
Yeah.
At the end of the day, even the gifts are meant to be a public support and an affirmation and confirmation of the truth of the gospel, that Jesus came into this world to save sinners, that he was raised from the grave on the third day, and that all who place their trust in him shall be saved. And anything that causes us to lose that focus is not from the Spirit.
It's of the evil one.
So,
amen.
So the glory of God, you and his church. Spirit.
So y'all know, 30 minutes.
Yeah,
I don't know.
How'd you feel about it?